Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Welcome to today's episode of Brains Matter. In this episode, we'll be talking about paleontology. And to tell us all about it, I spoke to Professor Patricia Vickers-Rich from Monash University. I'm speaking once again to Professor Pat Rich, who is the director of the Monash Science Centre. She was on a previous episode, so if you missed out on that, go back and listen to the episode on the Monash Science Centre. And today, we're going to talk to Professor Rich about paleontology and some of her research. So welcome to the show once again, Professor
Rich. Thank you. Nice to be back.
And firstly, for those who don't know, what is paleontology?
Ooh, that's a big question. paleontology, it's basically studying ancient life, and it can be anything from studying bacteria to studying elephants. So it's looking at how animals have changed through time, but it's also looking at the environments that they have changed in. And it's a very broad and very interesting field.
So is it just the animals, or does paleontology also include plants and trees and things like that?
Oh yeah, of course it does. I mean, you've got people who specialize in all of those, and their conclusions and assertions interface with lots of other parts of science, like chemistry, looking at the sediments and how they've formed and all of those kinds of things, how the continents have moved. You have to take that all into consideration when you're looking at the fossils.
So when you think about going back over hundreds of thousands to millions and multiples of millions
and billions
of years, and billions of years, it would seem that you would have to know about biology, you'd have to know about atmospheric chemistry, chemistry itself, biochemistry, geology, all those sorts of things. Mm-hmm. If someone's interested in paleontology, do they need to know all of that?
That's a good place to start. If you're doing, for instance, if you're doing reading in high school or whatever, and you get or you get into a university program, I always recommend that students study as broadly as they can, because you do need to know about chemistry, and you do need to know about physics, and you do need, if you, I'm a little bit inept at maths, but I tried the best I could, and if you're really smart at maths, I've got one graduate student right now who's doing a thing called finite element analysis, and that's a big fancy word for using mathematical models in trying to figure out how the skull of an ancient marsupial worked. I would say learn as broad as you can, and then you can specialize on a particular thing, but then you will realize where the interfaces are between your specific problem and everything else. And I also tell my students to learn a language or two, because paleontology and science in general is very international. And I know in my field, it has been really, really helpful to me to learn a little bit of Chinese, to learn a little bit of German, to learn a little bit of French, to learn a little bit of, I even was trying to learn one of the Indian languages when I went up to India on a recent field trip, and I failed on that one because it's too complicated. I can't read the alphabet.
Hindi, was it?
Yes. But you often will find that you are working in literature, for instance, that German is one of the languages that there was a lot of early paleontology put down in, and German is fairly straightforward to learn. So I tell my students, besides all of that, you might also learn a language or two along the way.
We touched briefly on your PhD in the previous interview. Do you want to go into that in a little bit more detail? What did you do for your PhD?
My PhD was looking at the origin of and trying to understand how it all came about of Australia's bird fauna. And so I had fossils that we had from rocks that went back to about 30 million years in Australia. One particular group that I was interested in were some really huge ground birds. In fact, they may have been the biggest birds that ever lived, and they may have even been larger than the elephant bird from Madagascar, and certainly were more bulky than moas and things like that.
And how big are we talking
about? We're talking about a 3-meter bird with a skull that's about maybe 3/4 meter long.
Wow.
They're huge. And when I was working on them, because of the we had a lot of material from the behind the head, but we didn't have much head, much cranial material. And so when I was working on them, they looked very, very much like cassowaries and emus. But as we got more and more material, it turns out that they're gigantic geese. So, and they're plant eaters. They're not carnivores. So they were the birds in Australia that really took the place of African giraffes and gazelles and things like that. The kangaroos, the smaller herbivores, were marsupials. But the big herbivores were either one group of big marsupials or these birds. So that's what I worked on, and it was fascinating. But I found after that, I went further and further and further back in time, and I've worked on a lot of other things besides birds.
What are some other areas of interest that you
have? My husband, who was interested in mammals, and I were both interested in looking at the origins of Australia's mammals and birds. So we looked in rocks that were older and older and older, and we got involved in some projects along the south coast of Australia that were in rocks about 110 million years, which was older than the bird stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a little bit of bird material, but there's a lot more now of the mammal material. And then I got fascinated, so that, you know, came back from 40 million years to about 100 million years. And we also had to work on dinosaurs. Not that I went looking for dinosaurs, we kept finding all these blooming dinosaurs, so we had to do something with them. And people are so fascinated with dinosaurs that that's where most of our funding came from. The National Geographic gave us a fair bit of funding to just chase dinosaurs. But in 2002, I became really fascinated with really, really old stuff, the origins of animals. So I hopped back to about 550 million years and started working on what were the ancestors for the first animals that we recognize, and that's what I'm working on now.
So 550 million years,
it's a while back.
Fair way.
Hard to imagine, really, in a human context.
At that point, the continents were all different as well, weren't they?
Yes, they were.
And so the animals that you were looking at that stage in Australia, were they very closely related to animals elsewhere in the world because of Pangaea and so forth?
Well, at that time, you were even before Pangaea, you're back to a place called Rodinia, which has got a lot of, it really is a huge, 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 huge continent. And yes, in fact, Australia has relationships with South America, many of the same kinds of relationships you have with later in time. So that there are things, for instance, in South America, there are things in Siberia, there are things in West Africa, etc., that look very much like the stuff that we find in Australia. But it's one of those times of mystery, too, because it's really hard when you go back that far in time. There's been so much activity going on and so much overprinting of information that sometimes it's pretty hard to decide who's related to, you know, what continents are related to what.
Mm-hmm.
I always remember one of my colleagues who is a person that works on reconstructing continents, and I wrote a book that summarized all this, and I asked him, I said, ENDL, which continental reconstruction should I use for this time?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, well, you could use mine, but if you want me to be honest, why don't you just put a series of these up on the different ones up on the wall, take a dart and throw it and see which one lands on. Because it's difficult when you're that far back in time to really reconstruct what the continental arrangement was.
Are there many surprises that you come across while you're doing your research?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's what research is so wonderful about. You're always finding something new if you're looking. You don't just take the given, quotes, truth or the given theory at the time as being correct. Science, as we've discussed before, science is an enterprise where you're constantly trying to disprove ideas.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something that's a bunch of facts that stay there and they're always the same. And to me, that's what really fascinated me about science, is the ability to know that you might be the first one that's made an observation.
Mm-hmm.
And then you put the observation out and you let other people test and see whether you've made a good observation or one that's not really defendable. And I like that. I like uncertainty.
Mm-hmm.
Many people don't, but I'm comfortable with uncertainty. It gives me something to wake up for in the morning and run around and try to figure out, you know, a little bit closer to what might be the reality.
Yeah, it reminds me of a quote, I don't remember who came up with it, but it's something that sticks in my mind. Real progress is made not when someone yells at Eureka, but when someone says, gee, that's funny.
Yes, yes indeed, that's right. Yeah, and then you have to start exploring and say, how do you put this and this together? I don't know yet. And then I find what I do is with something like that, that I will certainly go down my path, but I will call up my friends or get on the email to my friends and say, have you ever heard of anything like this? And sometimes they'll say, yeah, haven't you read the paper by Joe Bloggs?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'll say, oh, yeah, all right, I haven't. And he's already figured it out.
Mm-hmm.
But oftentimes it's like, yeah, hey, that's really kind of interesting. One thing that just came up not too long ago that was along those lines is, some of these animals that we're working with, if they're animals, they don't have hard parts like things do today that you're used to. They don't have shells that are made out of calcium carbonate like that, or calcium phosphate or whatever. But they do have, quotes, stiff parts, and wondering what those stiff parts are made out of, and they're shell-like. Sometimes they can be by themselves, and you'll find them as a fossil, but you know that they're not, they don't have crystalline structure. And I found out when I was in Kyoto, working on an Australian Academy Fellowship, and I was working on a book. I went over to one of the guys that was there, Nori Sato, who's working on tunicates, which are sea squirts. If you go along the beach, sometimes these things will, you know, squirt out water at you, and they're kind of related to us, but they just kind of look like bags, and you just don't really notice them very much. But I went over to see him, and he said some of these actually have these stiff parts, and they're made out of cellulose, which we normally associate with plants.
Yeah.
But what's happened, it seems, from his ideas, and he wrote a big review article in Nature about 4 years ago. He's the closest thing I've ever met to Einstein. He wrote it on genetics. And what he found is that these animals live in the past, much more so, live in such close association with microbial and algal mats that there's been something called lateral gene transfer. And I just read another article about this, where actual genetic material from the microbial mats was transferred and interlaced with the actual genome of the tunicate, so that the tunicate wasn't depending upon the plant to be in it to produce the cellulose, but it actually had the power to produce the cellulose itself.
Wow.
I just found this absolutely fascinating, and though I cannot prove it at the moment, I'm trying to think of ways of asking the fossils the questions I need to have answers to. It's possible that that's what the stiff part in these quote animals was. It's quite possible, because we can see this sort of thing happening in modern animals that we all agree are animals, and we all agree have now this spliced bit of cellulose production in their genome. And I just found that absolutely mind-blowing. I mean, just one conversation with a colleague said, whoa, you know, that's pretty cool.
and then this sort of brings up the fairly obvious question, is as you go further back and back in time, is there a point where plants and animals merged?
I think, of course.
Some point.
Yeah, of course. And when you get that far back in time, it's really difficult to say this is plant or this is animal. I mean, it had to go back to single-celled organisms. And I think the bridge across between single-celled and multi-celled very likely happened several times. You don't just find a, quote, common ancestor.
And now it's time for the listener of the episode. And today's listener of the episode is Sharon Ryan from Melbourne in Australia. Thanks for your support, Sharon. Now back to the interview.
People are always looking for common ancestors, and, well, fair enough, that's fine. But there's this lateral gene transfer, this business, and a number of other genetic tricks that go on. You literally can jump from something that looks one way, and then it jumps to something else in a very short period of time, looks entirely different. That's fascinating too. And so finding common ancestors is sometimes perhaps a fruitless enterprise.
Looking in the wrong direction.
Probably, yeah. I think things may have happened more than once.
So we mentioned the dinosaurs before. Normally people associate paleontology with dinosaurs.
Yeah.
What percentage of paleontologists look at dinosaurs, and what percentage look at various different other areas, and what areas are there?
Well, the number of people looking at dinosaurs would be a very small part of paleontology, although it's very high in the media. I mean, there's all kinds of other things for industry. People who look at microfossils look at things like what we call foraminifera, which are little one-celled organisms that actually build really hard shells out of carbonate, calcium carbonate and other things. Those can be very useful in helping date different levels of sediment, and if you're looking for oil, or you're looking for gold, or you're looking for something like that, that can help you narrow down the area. And those organisms were the ones that actually probably produced the oil, the organics in them. There's a number of people that work on those. There's a number of people that work on animals with no backbones. There's a number of people that work on mammals and birds and all sorts of things. So I think certainly dinosaurs gets a lot of the press. I'm never really quite sure why. I guess at the one end of the spectrum, you've got things like T-Rex, which is big and nasty, and you know, would have gobbled you up. But I had one kid say, "I like dinosaurs because I can imagine these really huge, awful animals, and I know they can't hurt me." So in a way, I think it's possibly that's got a lot to do with it. But dinosaurs are just amongst a whole array of very, very interesting things in the past.
So effectively, someone who's interested in paleontology can choose almost any area of interest and go back in time with that particular
they
area
can,
of interest.
They can, indeed. The problem, of course, is getting jobs when you come out the other end after that. I mean, it can be a hobby, but getting jobs, you have to also be fairly clever in making sure that you get a broad education, because you never know what the job market is going to be like when you come out.
Mm.
And one would hope that you can use the knowledge that you've got after you've put in all this work, and you can actually put bread on the table. But there's many different ways. I mean, I know one of my friends who got a PhD working on crocodiles, and he now works for the ABC on the Catalyst program.
Mm-hmm.
So he's a science communicator, and a very high-level science communicator. I like this because, you know, he knows the science. He knows to go to the experts in the field to get the information that he needs, and he's just a very clever man. And that's so there are other jobs besides just being a paleontologist, maybe doing research, or paleontologist teaching, environmental impact jobs.
Mm.
Because you, if you're looking at how the climate has changed or how environments have changed, you really don't need to restrict yourself just to human impact. In fact, if you want to know the impact of humans, you need to know what it was like before humans started impacting. So there's a range of jobs out there that people need to keep their eyes open for, and paleontology can give you the training for that kind of thing. And sometimes people just go and get another job completely, and it's a hobby with them. They come and work with scientists, but they do it as more of a vacation than they do it as a job.
So you mentioned some of the places around the world that you've been with your research. What was probably the most interesting place you went to, and what did you find there?
That would be impossible to tell you, because I find them all interesting. But I think one of the things I really enjoy when I go around the world is working with other people in different cultures. And one experience that I had that was just fantastic was one of my students is working in the highlands of Timor.
Mm.
He's from Singapore, and I've gotten to know his background in Singapore. But we went into Timor, and we went into the high country, and we were digging up fossil fish from the Jurassic, and everybody should know what the Jurassic is because of Jurassic Park, yes. But that's about 150, 160 million years ago. And we had to dig in a place that was on someone's property, and whenever you do that, not only do you get the permits from the government and from the federal government, from the local government and everybody concerned, you go around and you see everybody and be sure it's okay, but of course the most important thing is to get permission from the people upon whose land it is.
Mm-hmm.
And it just so happened that these fossil fish that we were digging out belonged to a family who had a magic man, a shaman in their family.
Mm-hmm.
And we got to know this shaman, and his interpretation of what these things were was extremely different than ours, which was wonderful to actually have contact with. And at first there was a great misunderstanding, and they were afraid we were going to destroy this, that, and the other thing, but over a period of 3 or 4 days, we got to be really, really lovely friends with these people, including the magic man.
Mm-hmm.
And I now have a picture that was taken by one of my colleagues of the magic man holding one of the fossil fish. And he's now been given an award from the University of Western Australia, who was giving us a lot. And it's hanging in the house of the magic man. And he's very proud of this and very pleased that we're working on his fossil fish, even though we have very, very different ideas about where this fossil fish came from.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the interaction. The science is wonderful, but the interaction with different cultures and different people is just as fascinating to me as doing the science.
I'm presuming there's a lot of that cultural learning that you get along the way as well, because that example you gave where that magic man might have a different view of where that came from and all the stories that come along with it. When you do Australian research, there might be some Dreamtime explanations of those fossils, and perhaps some of those have a logical connection which might
of
help with research
do.
As well.
Yes, of course they do. Mm. And it's used in, and I think what I really like is that when you actually get to know and work with people in different cultures, and they understand you're not there to destroy their culture, you're not there to destroy their ideas, but the two of you can work together, that's where I really feel good, because there doesn't need to be the antagonism that sometimes can exist. And it really is very personality dependent. I mean, you can get people, if you've got people who've got big egos and blah blah blah, it probably isn't going to work.
Mm-hmm.
But what you need to do is you need to be respectful of both sides. Both of you need to be respectful towards each other. Not necessarily either one of you has, quote, the truth, but you're exploring from different perspectives, and I think just respect of each one's perspective is something that's very, very important.
So peace through science.
That's a good start. And I think in a lot of places that I've worked, you know, there, where there really are conflicts, that science and science communication and just communication with different people can really be very helpful in bringing that about. So anyway.
All right, so for people who are interested in following this path for a career, you mentioned before getting exposed to as many different aspects of science as possible. Are there any other things that they should consider if they want to become a paleontologist?
Well, I think anybody who's going for a degree in anything, I think they just need to keep their mind open to other things that might relate. I mean, as I was talking to you about learning languages, it doesn't hurt. I remember one of the things I did at the University of California, Berkeley, that was very helpful to me because I work across a lot of different cultures. I took two courses, Middle Eastern language and religion and Far Eastern languages and religion, and it was very, very enlightening to me to get the history and of the religions and of the cultures in these different places and the languages and things like that. I think that would be a really good way to go. So I would encourage people to take courses that have nothing to do with science. And in the U.S. system, it's easy to do that because you're expected to have 4 years of undergraduate training, and you have to take what they call broadening courses. So if you're in arts, you need to take some courses in science. If you're in science, you need to take some courses in arts. And I think that is really helpful. I mean, one of the places that it was helpful to me is I've led two expeditions into central Saudi Arabia, and having read their religious documents, their religious books, and understanding trying to understand their culture has been very helpful for both sides. And the same thing in other places I've worked, in China, for instance, in Japan. It's just a, in a way, it's almost a responsibility, I would think, of people that are going to be doing that kind of thing. You need to try to understand. It's not just you coming in and saying, I want to do this, and I'm going to do this, and everything else is not related. Everything really, in a way, is interrelated. So I would say my advice would be is to get as broad an education as you can. Read the classics. If you've got time, learn Latin. This is when we went through high school, we had to learn Latin or Greek. I mean, I know I'm old and you don't do that anymore because you're too busy learning how to work with the IT, and that's another aspect I'm really dumb with regard to that. But my son is a great techie and he helps me out. So there's all these other things that you have to learn now as a person going through school. But I say don't forget the cultural, don't forget the language, don't forget the history of other parts of the world and things like that when you're learning all these other technical things. And in fact, the technical things can help. You type in something like the culture of northern India or the culture of Iraq or something like that, and you're liable to come up with all kinds of interesting articles you can read. Well, read them. After you've found them, then read them and try to understand them.
Well, that's great advice, and I'd just like to thank you once again for appearing on the show.
It's been great. Thank you for coming back and asking me more questions.
And if anyone has any further questions about paleontology, please leave a comment on this episode's entry and I'll forward them through.
Thank you. I'll be happy to answer.
And that's the end of the interview, for now anyway. If you enjoyed hearing Professor Vickers-Rich or you want to learn more about dinosaurs, then you're in luck. The Brainsmatter podcast, along with the Monash Science Centre, is holding a National Science Week event on Sunday the 15th of August, starting from 11 a.m. I'll be interviewing Professor Vickers-Rich and there'll be a whole host of things to do. You might even win a prize. For details, check out the Brainsmatter website or look up details in the event on Facebook. If you have any questions, just send me an email. And I hope all the people who won the website competition and received their double pass to the movie Farewell enjoy the movie. Thanks to Hopscotch Films for the prizes. And finally, I'll leave you with a quote from Erica Jong. Advice is what we ask for when we already know the answer, but wish we didn't. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show.
You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right-hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.